Jigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigjigj
So Rinpoche gives his greeting to all of those who have come today to attend his teaching and to listen to the Dharma.
Mm.
So what do we mean when we talk of Dharma? Generally speaking, in ordinary life in this world, we tend to discriminate between ourselves and others. When it comes to Dharma practice, the key of Dharma practice is to have a vast, a broad mind, which does not discriminate between ourselves and others, but which equalizes self and others. So, although there are countless numbers of spiritual teachings in this world of ours, countless dharmas, we should reflect on the fact that the actual goal of all these spiritual teachings is the same. It is the equal benefit of oneself and of others. However, there is an uncommon characteristic of Buddha Dharma. The Tibetan term is actually the Dharma of Buddha of the insiders, which is that Buddha Dharma's goal is to lead all sentient beings to full enlightenment. So this is the uncommon feature of Buddha Dharma. It's a little bit like if you were to plant a grain in the ground. Each grain has its own characteristics, and some grains are quite specific in their results. So whereas from the standpoint of the basis, which is the mind, there is no difference between sentient beings and Buddhas, from the standpoint of the mode of apprehension the mind has of phenomena, there is a big difference in that the mind of sentient beings has a mode of apprehension whereby objects are apprehended as existing inherently, as it were. The mind of a Buddha does not have such a mode of apprehension. And when one's mind is developed so that it becomes infinitely vast in terms of its love and compassion, then one becomes a fully enlightened being. And one of the main characteristics of such a mind is its heroism, its heroic propensities to help other beings. So today we are going to engage in the practice, receive the initiation, engage in the practice of the glorious Tara. Now actually, the glorious Tara and ourselves are one and the same. She is a woman, and there are many women in this audience. So why do we say that the glorious Tara is a Buddha, whereas we, for instance, are not at present Buddhas? It's because the glorious Tara from her side has infinitely developed the wish to benefit others, to give others happiness and the causes of happiness, and to free them from suffering and the causes of suffering. Through infinitely developing her mind in this respect, she has become fully enlightened. So what do we mean when we talk of Buddhahood? The Tibetan term is Sangye. It has two syllables. The first syllable is Sang, has many meanings, but here it means specifically to dispel. To dispel what? To dispel the sense of our own self, clinging at our own self, and to increase the attention we pay to others. The second syllable, gye, has a meaning in Tibetan of to expand. What do we mean by expanding here? We mean to expand infinitely the care with which we see others and the care with which we take care of others. So that is a meaning of the term sangye and its two syllables in Tibetan. So from the standpoint of the characteristics of a Buddha, what do we mean? Well, we mean at the beginning attaining the various qualities of a Buddha. But in the middling state, what we actually mean is to develop a mind which is omniscient, which understands everything in the past, the present, and the future. Specifically, which understands the condition of beings in the past, the present, and the future. This is what we mean when we speak of becoming a Buddha. So with regards to the effect, what do we mean by Buddhahood, the result attained? There are three bodies of the Buddha which are actually of one nature. These three bodies are the Dharmakaya, the Sambhogakaya, and the Nirmakaya, or in English, the body of the Dharma, the body of emanation, and the body of manifestation. Now, whereas all Buddhas are of one nature, in that there is no difference actually between them, they manifest differently for the benefits of beings. And at the level of the Sambhogakaya, for instance, they manifest to some beings as Aryatara, as the glorious Tara. Whereas at the level of the Nirmanakaya, they manifest to beings such as, for instance, in the shape of His Holiness the Dalai Lama, who manifests as a glorious Bodhisattva. However, ultimately, all of these manifestations of the Buddha are of one nature. Now today, when we practice Aryatara, we must keep in mind that all of the Buddhas are of one nature with her, and she is of one nature with all of them. So, to develop somewhat this notion of the three bodies, all of the Buddhas have the same Dharmakaya, which is of the nature of space. Buddhas differ with respect to their Sambhogakaya, which are the very many manifestations of the Buddha to help beings, to eliminate the suffering of beings and to lead them to happiness. And there are countless Nirmanakayas which manifest in the history of our various countries. All we have to do is study the history of our countries, such as your country, Estonia, to see that there were great beings who worked for the benefit of others. And these are probably Nirmanakayas. Now, in the Dharma, we have such beings as the glorious Tara, which manifests to help others. In Christianity, we have other beings such as the Virgin Mary, the mother of Jesus, who is certainly also a manifestation of the Buddhas. These are the manifestations which come in this world to help suffering beings. So, what is the characteristic of these holy beings, these gods, whether they are Buddhist or Christian? The characteristic is that they have bodhicitta. If they have bodhicitta, then they are holy beings. On the other hand, we have disincarnate entities without bodies, who are similar in appearance to these gods. They appear in the bardo, but they don't have bodhicitta. For that reason, these are demons. So the main difference between a god and a demon lies in the mind. It is the presence or the absence of this holy mind of bodhicitta. So we are now going to engage in the practice of the glorious white Tara. As you see, the booklet contains many pages, but the beginning and the very essence of this entire practice can be summarized in 2 points. The first is refuge. The second is bodhicitta. Refuge is a foundation because it's in dependence on refuge that we engage in the practice and become a Buddhist. We take refuge in the teacher, the Buddha, without whom there would be no teachings. The Dharma, which is what is taught by the Buddha, which is the actual practice. And good followers with good minds of the Buddha, helpers, this is the Sangha, which helps us on the path. Without these three, there is no refuge.
Tene tela se chamne jipti romala kocho som ka changge yori sangje churo kong jom di ma de na gangi de ge de gen du song de tam ju tok de sangje yemen jipti du ma jipola kocho som changge yori.
Now, in the case of Aryatara, we can say that she summarizes, she completes, if you want, all three jewels. All three jewels are present in her. She is a manifestation of the Buddha, she teaches the Dharma, and her assembly is, or the group around her, is the Sangha. So, why should we take refuge in the glorious Tara? We should take refuge in the glorious Tara because she has completed the two characteristics of Buddhahood. Her mind is omniscient, so she knows instantaneously the suffering and the difficulties of every single sentient being. And her loving compassion is infinite in that she sees every sentient being as her very own child, and she acts immediately to help all beings. Now, if this is the case, and she has what we call the complete wisdom and the 18 forms of love, then why should we beseech her for help? And Rinpoche says it's a little bit as if we have a child. However great the love of the mother, if the child has no mouth to call out for help or to receive the food, for instance, which the mother will give it, then the mother cannot help the child. That is the reason for which we have to ask for help, to beseech in prayers the help of Tara.
So
So in addition to the two characteristics of compassion and wisdom, we have to generate two additional characteristics of the glorious Tara, which are and can be viewed as conjoined, her deeds and activities. What are the deeds and activities of the glorious Tara? The deeds and activities of Tara are her countless manifestations for the benefits of being, to help beings in the countless forms. These are her deeds and her activities. Now, what do we mean when we say that we generate the glorious Tara within our mind stream? We mean by this that we generate the very characteristics of Tara, and specifically her bodhicitta. The benefits of generating bodhicitta are both conventional or temporary and ultimate. They are temporary, or they are related to this very life, in that even in this very life, our situation will improve and our suffering will decrease. But they are ultimate also, in that through generating bodhicitta, we eventually attain full enlightenment. Therefore, the practice of Tara entails a generation of bodhicitta. Therefore, after having generated refuge as a foundation of our practice, it is critical to generate bodhicitta as the next step. Why is this the case? This is so because if on the basis of the practice of white Tara, we generate bodhicitta within our mind, then everything we do becomes a cause for attaining the condition of white Tara, the state of full enlightenment as Tara. It's a little bit as when one makes jewelry. One will put great effort into manufacturing something beautiful. However, it is important that the base material one uses is precious and valuable. If, for instance, one puts great effort in making ornaments out of gold, for instance, then these things will become very beautiful and will be called jewelry. If one puts the same effort into making things out of earth or iron or stone, let's say, then however much the effort, ultimately the base material is coarse, and it's something we look at and just throw away, saying this is earth, this is stone, this is irrelevant and meaningless. Therefore, it is critical in the sadhanas, where we visualize ourselves as Tara, that we do this on the foundation of the mind of bodhicitta. Therefore, what should we do in the beginning? In the beginning, we should say, I will benefit all other beings, and to do this, I will generate bodhicitta. This is of benefit to oneself and to others. Now, with this, we have finished the explanation of the preliminaries of the sadhana.
Yeah.
So
나지면 어서 담아 상기해 대변나. 얘나 오 섭지 제마 다도 끼끼끼로 나지 담아니 요 말해지. 매바감이 근데 다 나지 그 점이나 오래 동해 담아니 담아 깨차래 대변나. 대시들은 오 빼 산족 섭지도 빼 자치 보이 봐 드니 무슨네 드니 딱관 냠니 고니 요거 빠르 드니 다치지 로 따니 맞지와. 심지어는 핑고 삼아 로만 드니 냠니 제나 드니 냠니도 받치 매반 드베 침보.
So, once we have generated bodhicitta, then the very foundations of Buddhahood are present. Why is this so? This is so because the main root of the afflictions is the mind cherishing the self. This mind cherishing the self is that from which all the afflictions and ultimately the non-virtuous karma arises. That mind which clings to ourself. Once we generate bodhicitta, that mind has no space to be. It ceases to exist. Therefore, it is critical to generate bodhicitta and to cut the root of psychic existence. It's as the root of a tree we cut. The tree ceases to exist when we cut the root. Likewise, when we eliminate the mind cherishing the self, psychic existence ceases for us. So after the preliminaries, we now engage in practices to dispel the obstructions, to dispel the interferences. In general, these interferences are the delusions, such as anger, envy, jealousy, and all these negative emotions. Specifically in this case, these are entities which are possessed by these negative emotions. And the way we dispel these negative emotions in general, and these entities which carry them in particular, is that we offer a small torma. And we visualize that this torma, this little ritual cake of Tibetan flour and butter with a bit of sugar, etc., this basically satisfies them completely. It satisfies their visual sense and their sense of taste, and they are quite satisfied, and they feel no anger, no irritation with us, and leave us alone to practice. This is how we dispel the obstructions. So we have now reached page 3 of your sadhana. And when we read the passage, I manifest as the exalted lady from whose heart light radiates, etc., we visualize ourselves as glorious white Tara, and we emanate countless rays of light of the nature of love to help all beings, especially those beings in whose hearts there is anger, hatred, jealousy. And we visualize that when the light touches them, their minds are completely pacified and they become peaceful and happy.
Mm. Nyima go na tini Nyima go ka che chanare kangwe nang la chatu go mare ya mi dongye chi go Nyima chan pin tho yo mare je wa go wo je na pe na mi je wa chi go mi chi chan dongye chi bo de yo na ta ro bo na to bo chi go de ka ba tang na je nam jo la sam sem de wa le ku yo re je wa go wo de tini re tini go je wa chi bo de ta sa ri ang go so ji chen de tru de na so go sem ji tam je je wa chi bo chi na san ji tam ji pe ga go yo re sem ji tam je la de ga pin go yo re
Now, the second line on page 3, again, white light radiates through the Buddha fields of the ten direction, becomes an invitation to the transcendent lady Buddhas and bodhisattvas. This white light, which the sadhana refers to, is of the nature of the love and compassion of Aryatara. Now, such a light reaches to the infinities of space to help all beings. It is infinitely more powerful, for instance, than the light of the sun. The light of the sun, however beneficial it is, cannot reach inside a house through walls to help beings who are suffering, nor can it actually help suffering per se. The light we emanate, the white light we emanate as Aryatara, can reach through all obstacles to help all beings. It is, if you want, like somebody who is suffering and who gets a phone call from an old friend. The moment he gets this phone call, his mind lightens up. He becomes happy. The phone call has eliminated temporarily his suffering. The light we emanate from our body does the same for all beings.
So,
I did not translate at the end of the previous section that Rinpoche said that because we generate this powerful mind of bodhicitta, all Buddhas are greatly rejoiced to see this within our mind stream and then come to help us. Now, once we generate such a mind, then this mind, if we extend it to the entire known universe, to all beings in the universe, becomes extraordinarily vast. It's not the case that our small body, which is very limited with its strong self-attachment, goes all over the world to help beings. It is our mind, which has no limit, which extends to the entire universe to help all suffering beings inside. And this, in turn, becomes a very vast and powerful mind. So then Rinpoche said, we are now on page 4, by the way, of your text. You visualize in the space in front of you, invited by these rays of light, not only White Tara, but the Buddhas of all three times surrounding her, as vast as space. And then one engages in the various practices listed in the text, which are basically the seven-limb offering. One prostrates, one makes offerings, practices confession, rejoices, etc.
Oh,
So now on page four, we have, as we said previously, the practice of the seven-limbed prayer. The seven-limbed prayer has various sequences in the various traditions, but all seven limbs are always present, and it's indispensable to practice it at the beginning. Here, the first limb is a limb of prostration. With respect, I prostrate, I pay homage. What is the importance of prostration? Prostration is actually the antidote to the evil of pride. It is quite easy for pride to arise in our mind if we are healthy and, for instance, we have a good situation, we are wealthy. And then we think, I'm healthy, I have a lot of money, you know, I'm doing very well. But we must keep in mind that this is merely the result of past good karma, and that undeniably, even someone in that situation will die one day. And for sure, at the time of death, there will be suffering. So through the limb of prostration, through the practice of prostration, we set up the antidote to pride at the beginning of our practice. So as we said previously, the limb of prostration is the antidote to pride. Now the next limb, the limb of offering, is the antidote to desire in general and to avarice and cupidity in particular. Why is this the case? If we think of how avarice and cupidity manifest, they are a desire for everything. We want to own things, we want to have things, and we want them to be ours and not to belong to others. For instance, Rinpoche gives the instance of the apple in front of him. When the mind of cupidity, of avarice appears, it says, I want this apple to be mine. I want to eat it myself, and I don't want anyone else to eat it. Now, the way to counter this mind is first to offer this apple to the triple gem. When we offer the apple to the triple gem, the self-cherishing mind is harmed. It is damaged by this. And then it is legitimate for us to consume the apple because we consume it with a pure mind. And in so doing, we eliminate the stains of avarice and cupidity on our mind stream. The key is to understand that the seven-limb prayer is a succession of practices designed to purify our minds and to eliminate all the stains from our mind stream.
Same the tip of chat, tongue, go on to the yomber, tongue, maybe pay, can you go? 다다 나는 벌써는 나한테 매와 차서 나거든 박차 야요 말이. 권조스는 벌써 세 조발했더니 도좀 직진 감탐지 참아 심지 나지 누구 탐지 권조스는 벌써 난게 조발했더니 라가 다도 버 총마 룰롱주 라가 루당께 막 권조스는 벌써 이제 드니 셈이 또 오 참아 권조스는 그래 나 직장 매서 드니 셈 이거 양 뭐 차들이 난게 조발하지 제 조발 난게 조발하지 조발이
So, with respect to the two first offerings, the outer and the inner offering, let us analyze somewhat more what are the benefits of making these offerings. When we are strongly attached to things, when we lust after objects, we want everything to be ours, everything which surrounds us, all the objects of enjoyment which we see around us. Now, in daily life, this might be possible, but certainly at the time of death, it will not be possible. There will no longer be things which we can possess as we have to leave this life without even our body. And through this constant attachment to things in this life, we will have implanted very strong karmic proclivities, very strong karmic instincts to have a very powerful sense of self-cherishing in future lives. For that reason, it is very important to offer mentally not just food, but for instance, one's wives, or wife, one's children, one's possessions to the Buddha. And then when one offers them like this to the Triple Gem, this clinging mind disappears and one becomes free with respect to them.
Naga Lude, Simpy Tamkir, Pimpers, the Gypsy Roman, Pujo, oh, Conjosum, but you conjosum great, reported the Samson. Then Naga Kalasana, conjosum great, Petrut on the Simpkin, Jimping, Dukoyore, then Lumber, what in it, Pium Chimbo, Taparatin, Nanga Chupala, Lu. Then Sami Chupala Kare, Jimping, Lord, Dandi, on the Tab, Simpy Tamkir, Pingo, Sammy. Managing Dona, oh, Nang is home to getting out the Quachimbo Sangomery. Simply Tamjil Pingo, Man Bimu, Man Bimu Santana, this amateur about the dancing on the Jimping Lodgiba, Tatin Chupa Chishu, Sen Nang Sang Chu Murder, then Chupa Sum Yurwa, Chi Nang Sang Chupa Sum.
Now, we are going to enter in more detail into the second offering, the inner offering. The inner offering is an offering of the bodily substances. We do this because one of the great sources of our attachment is our own body. We feed our body, we clothe our body, we cover it with ornaments. We go to countless trouble to adorn and take care of our body. Through offering our body to the Buddhas of the three times and to Jetsun Dolma in particular, we free ourselves from this attachment. So this is the reason of the inner offering. As to the secret offering, it's an offering of mental states, of mental experiences, such as, for instance, the virtue which has been accumulated through good karma, the thoughts of helping others, you know, the idea of benefiting all beings. These states of mind are offered to the Buddhas of the three times and to Aryatara in particular.
The Pashaquin, you know, the Shedang Zoe, but in Yumo, but Shabachi, I already. Shabachi, Juba, oh, Chumago, some day. Dekwa Zonson, the Shabayan, Kichuwa.
So as to the third limb, the limb of confession, in the text we have the passage, I confess all faults or all evils. This is a specific antidote to anger. It's the specific affliction which is purified by this limb. And it is very clearly stated by the Buddha in all his teachings that anger must be eliminated completely from our mind stream. If we become familiar with anger, if again and again anger, irritation, jealousy, envy are generated in our minds, then at the time of death, the mind becomes very difficult. There is great suffering, and for sure in future lives, there is even greater suffering. So through practicing this limb of confession, we purify specifically anger, and whenever anger arises in our mind, we must think to ourselves, this is an affliction. I have no time for this. I have no need for this. May this be completely dispelled from my mind. The Buddha has taught again and again that this is harmful and meaningless. And in so doing, we will practice correctly the limb of confession.
ຖ້າດໍກະນີ້ບໍ່ຍິດຊິຍາລະຍາລະເກວ່າລະຍາລະລະດົງກໍຈິຖ້າດໍດະເປຍນິວບໍ່ຊົງຊົງດໍຄໍສຸນນໍາເສບຍາລະເປນລະຄັງນີ້ດິນລະຊິລະຕິນລະຖ້າດໍຢູ່ກໍລະຍໍຕິນລະຕິນລະຖ້າດໍຢູ່ກໍລະເປນລະປໍປິນດານິປໍປິນນີ້ນະອໍຈິກເປສຸກໍຈານລະຈິບໍທີຖ້າດໍຢູ່ລະດາຈິຍະພາມາຈິບໍລະປໍປິນຍາລະຍິນນະຍັງດາຈູປິຍາທີລະຖ້າດໍຈິກໍຖ້າດໍທີຈິນກາລະຍິນນະຈິຍາຫາມາຊ
So the fourth limb, the limb of rejoicing, is the antidote to envy. Now, what in general, envy is actually a rather small delusion. It is the delusion which can kill, which can put an end to whatever virtue and merit we have accumulated. Envy is that mental process whereby whenever somebody else is happy or is doing well, we feel irritation in our mind and we feel a wish that this person should not do well. Now this happens within families, between two children. When one child is told by his parents that he looks really good, the other child will feel envy, irritation. He will want that the child which is looking good not look well. Or it happens between relatives as well. In all cases, this envy, far from being the cause of ourselves doing better, is the karmic cause of ourselves doing worse than before. And therefore, it's very important to put an end to envy, and the way to do so is through rejoicing, through being happy in the virtue, in the merit, in the good deeds of others, in whatever possessions they have. So rejoicing is the way of accumulating very easily, for oneself the merit of others. For instance, if somebody were to do a long retreat over several years, which we ourselves are unable to do, through rejoicing in the fact that they're doing a long retreat for several years, we will accumulate an amount of merit similar to the one they have accumulated. Or let us say someone has a very handsome physique, a very powerful body. Instead of feeling envy through rejoicing at the fact that this person is very handsome, very strong, we ourselves will create the karmic causes for getting ourselves a handsome and strong body in future lives.
Naturally,
there are cases where it is unsuitable to rejoice. For instance, if somebody is undergoing great suffering or great difficulties, then it is unsuitable to indulge in what the Germans call Schadenfreude, rejoicing in the problems of others. Instead, one should generate compassion in one's mind and think, how terrible this person is undergoing this, how sad, you know, I wish I myself could do something for them. The fifth limb now is the limb of requesting the turning of the wheel of the law. In other words, the limb whereby we request the Buddha to teach. This limb is the antidote to being separated from the teachings. We are requesting the Buddhas to turn the wheel of the Dharma, to turn the wheel of the law, that beings never be separated from the teachings, and that they understand the means to attain happiness and the causes of happiness, and the means to be liberated from suffering and the causes of suffering. This is the meaning of the fifth limb. The sixth limb, which is a limb beseeching the Buddhas to remain, is, among other things, the antidote to the wrong views and the doubts which arise, which lead us to think that perhaps there are no Buddhas, or perhaps there was only one Buddha, the Buddha of our present age, but before and after there were no Buddhas. Or some people even say that the Buddha, when his life ends, ceases to exist. These are all wrong views, and this limb, the sixth limb, is the antidote to that. By requesting the Buddhas to abide permanently, to remain permanently, we are generating in our mind stream the conviction that since beginningless time there have been Buddhas which have been manifesting endlessly for the benefits of beings. So we are now coming to the last of the seven limbs on the first line of the second paragraph of page 4. I dedicate all virtue for great awakening. The meaning of this act of dedication is to protect our roots of virtue from destruction by anger, for instance. If great anger were to arise in our stream, in our mind stream, it would destroy the roots of virtue we have accumulated. In other words, the positive karma we have accumulated would be destroyed by anger. Also, it's possible to have a strong sense of self arising through thinking, I have accumulated a lot of merit, I will do very well for myself in the future. Then we become very attached to the positive karma we have created. Through the process of giving it away, as it were, of dedicating it to all the Buddhas, then no attachment arises in our minds, and it is protected from destruction by anger. Then after this, we visualize the entire field of accumulation surrounding us, White Tara and all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas of the three times, dissolving into our heart. It is not that we are actually identical with White Tara, but we are very similar to the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas visualized in front of us. Then when they dissolve into our heart, we feel a feeling of great happiness, of great bliss arise in our mind, as if our mind becomes one with theirs. And we must imagine very strongly that all the qualities of the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas, such as, for instance, the four immeasurable minds, arise within our mind stream. And in dependence upon this, our mind is purified and becomes like a mirror. It is able to reflect exactly everything it perceives. now pass to page 5, and the verse reads, from within emptiness appears the holy land of Akanishta. Now, what do we mean here by emptiness? Whereas phenomena appear to us as true, as truly established, actually they are not true. They are not truly established. They do not exist in the way they appear. From a worldly standpoint, to give an example, we could say it's a little bit like the moon reflecting in a pond. The moon appears to be on the surface of the pond, but everyone knows that actually the moon is not in the pond. In the same way, when we analyze these phenomena which surround us, we find that they are all marked by impermanence, and yet they do not appear to be impermanent. So if we analyze phenomena, we find that under analysis, phenomena cease to exist, they cease to be established. Therefore, we say these phenomena are empty. For instance, Rinpoche was giving the example of himself and his translator. If we look at each other, we might think, well, this body is the body of the translator. But under analysis, it's very clear this body is not the body of the translator. Is actually not the translator, excuse me. Then if we analyze further and we think perhaps the mind of this translator is this translator which we are trying to find. When we try to find the mind, we cannot find it. It disintegrates under analysis. It is not established. And therefore, it disappears into emptiness. It is from this emptiness, this absence of establishment, that we generate the pure land of Akanishta.
Ole,
So then we visualize in front of ourselves the land of Akanishta. As a matter of fact, Rinpoche points out that there are many similarities between our bodies with its four elements and its various constituents on the one side, and the various manifestations of the Buddhas, specifically the five Dhyani Buddhas, which represent various purified states of mind, various afflictions which are purified. And these similarities are very present throughout Tantra. Now, in the case of the Pure Land which we visualize in front of ourselves, this Pure Land has many pure objects which are described in the sadhana, such as pure trees, jewels, and ornaments of various types.
Now,
this Pure Land, as we were saying, is visualized with countless beautiful ornaments. The importance of this visualization is to eliminate the mind which is constantly discriminating between what is good and what is not good, what is clean and what is unclean. Instead, we should view all phenomena as actually of one nature. And these pure lands, such as Akanishta, for instance, exist around us, as well as many other pure lands. Now, within these pure lands, we have many symbols, such as the flowers, which are symbols, or, for instance, the moon seed, which is a symbol of bodhicitta. Now, Jetsun Drolma, Arya Tara, is seated on a moon seat and on a lotus, which symbolize respectively bodhicitta and renunciation. Now, at this stage, we are engaging in practices of the generation stage. It's very important to understand the distinction between practices which precede the generation stage, during which we visualize the body as indeed the product of non-virtuous karma, as unclean, dirty, a source of suffering, which it is in actuality, and the practices of the generation stage where we are placing the karmic imprints to actualize the body of a Buddha. At that time, we discard our ordinary vision of the body as unclean, and it's instead we visualize our body as pure. Generally speaking, it is said that there are four aspects of the practice of the generation stage. And through engaging in these four aspects, for instance, when we walk, we visualize ourselves as a deity we are practicing with bodhicitta within our mind. This lays powerful imprints for arising at that as that deity in the process of death. So I made a mistake in my translation. It's not the four points of the generation stage, it's the four types of birth Rinpoche is referring to. The four types of birth, the terms the same in Tibetan, are first birth from a womb, secondly birth through spontaneous generation, thirdly birth through heat, and fourthly, firstly birth through a womb, second birth from an egg, thirdly, birth through spontaneous generation, and fourthly, miraculous emanation. These are the four types of birth we can have, according to Abhidharma.
Tini tata di rumi chiyanam de pachere metodani chiwa tepe 이제
So then, in the context of the sadhana, we manifest instantaneously, miraculously, as in the fourth type of birth, as a syllable tam in the center of the moon disk on top of the lotus. This syllable tam is of the nature of Aryatara, of the two minds of Aryatara, the wisdom and the mind of infinite compassion. And from this syllable tam, which instantaneously manifests, countless beams of light emanate, and they accomplish the benefit of all beings throughout space.
Mm. Choga Mlova Kona Mate Tini Miso Jagab Tini Jonjo Jerum Laga Shatang Yasham Tinghana Sham Tite Makat Ta Yanda Yangda Ta Tini Maksum Yang Yang Chala Semlani Tini Semlani Tini Lai Uji Chalun Dini the Rage of the Mara Samlotang Tini Pedi Bade Ma Samlotang Tini Ya Samlotang Rage of the Samlotang Tini Sam the Ramon of what you were Tini Sam the Ramon Lagi Ladi Yangta Yanda Samlotang Tini te semla zong samti gom tini je gom la. Tini choga lobo kani lapsang rani kechik de tini lapsang semla tari te shari yung gori. Tini te shari la tini te zong la tini tini tango koi namba di yili shari tini je gom gori de.
So when we practice the generation stage, we do not visualize ourselves instantaneously as the deity. It's a process of gradual generation, where we rely, for instance, on a tanka, like the tanka of White Tara to Rinpoche's left. And we repeatedly study the tanka, we look at the tanka, and familiarize ourselves with the characteristics of White Tara, and then we visualize ourselves from the top of the body down with progressively more and more of the characteristics until we reach our feet, and then we move back upwards, visualizing the body in the other direction as the body of White Tara, a little bit as a painter. When a painter paints, he paints the deity gradually. And then eventually, through repeated familiarization with this, we gain the capacity to visualize ourselves as White Tara instantaneously. Then, as you will see when you observe the tanka of White Tara, White Tara has many ornaments. Now, these ornaments are culturally defined or culturally limited. These are ornaments in the Indian tradition, just as there were on other paintings ornaments which are more in the Tibetan tradition, and there are other traditions like the Chinese tradition of ornaments for the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. This is not actually the way things are. These ornaments merely symbolize the qualities of White Tara, such as her bodhicitta. And we must then visualize them accordingly. The two mudras are important in that they are respectively the mudra of supreme generosity and the second mudra. Both of these mudras have profound meaning, which we have to keep in mind while we meditate. Now, in general, it is said that there are 13 different categories of ornaments on the Sambhogakaya. These 13 different categories of ornaments represent the 13 grounds of the Bodhisattva, which leads from the first ground of the path of seeing all the way up to the state of Buddha Vajradhara. So whenever we think or we visualize a Buddha with these 13 ornaments, what is important is that we bring to mind instantaneously the 13 grounds and generate happiness with our mind stream, within our mind stream, while we are thinking of this.
Then
we visualize upon our crown as White Tara, the manifestation of Buddha, Buddha Amitayus, excuse me, Buddha Amitabha. Now, Buddha Amitabha here is the master of the family to which White Tara belongs, which is the family of the lotus. In the same way as, for instance, Avalokiteshvara belongs to the family of the lotus. And we visualize in the three sites, which is the crown, the throat, and the center of the body, the three syllables, Om Ahung. So the profound meaning which bedecking the body of the Buddha with these three syllables Om Ahung signifies is that all of the infinite, all of the countless manifestations of the Buddhas are merely manifestations of the very same white Om, which represents the body of all the Buddhas, red A, which represents the speech of all the Buddhas, and blue Hung, dark blue Hung, which represents the mind of all the Buddhas. Therefore, these three syllables signify the unity of all the manifestations of the countless Buddhas of the three times.
So the
제 곰드나 상이 쇼가 집지 좀 찍을 섭 템로 요래 오래 참아 템로 가가요 말에 네.
Now, when we engage in these visualizations, we have to unite the factor of clarity and the factor of emptiness. This is obviously not something which is done visually. In other words, we do not actually see with our visual organ the manifestations of White Tara. It is done in the mind, mentally. It's a process of visualization in the mind where we try to unite at the same time the mental appearance of the body of White Tara with the fact that it is empty of existence from its own side. These two are brought together. This is very important because then later on in the death process and in the bardo, when these very difficult or frightening appearances appear to us, we can see them all as white taras. Now, with our own eyes, we do not see these, and in our very life here and now, we do not see Buddhas, but we put effort into visualizing the presence of white Tara around us and all the Buddhas as Tara. Now we therefore visualize on our body four syllables. We visualize a syllable, white syllable om on the crown, the red syllable ah in the throat. We visualize a syllable hong not in the heart as usual, but at the level of the navel, because at the level of the heart we have a syllable tam, which is the germ syllable of Tara. Now from the syllable tam, light emanates, and this light invites all of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas to come to us in the form of the Buddhas of the five families. The Buddhas of the five families include all the Buddhas of all three times. And they settle and enter into us within the crown, within the top of our head. So we are on page 6 of your Estonian text, and you visualize then the Buddhas of the five families entering through the crown, and at that point it is very important to generate a strong sense of indissociableness, of inseparableness from White Tara. Not to think there is me and White Tara, the two of us, but instead to think I am totally one, totally fused with White Tara. I am indissociable from her.
Now
So then we utter the Sanskrit syllables Ja Hum Ba Moho, and we become indissociable from Aryatara. Now it is critical here, Rinpoche says, to keep in mind that the most important thing at this point is that our mind be totally fused with the four immeasurables: immeasurable love, immeasurable compassion, immeasurable equanimity, and immeasurable joy. When our mind is totally fused with these four immeasurables, we are naturally one with White Dara. Otherwise, however good the visualization, if our mind is not fused with these four immeasurables, there is no question that we are not one with White Dara. Now, having generated ourselves indissociably as one with Aryatara, we then make the traditional offerings, the Indian offerings, Argam, Bayam, Pushpe, etc. Now, these offerings, again, are culturally bound. Those of you who have been to India know that India is a very hot country. So the first thing you do when you receive an honored guest, which we are now because we are one with Dara and we have also invited Buddhas surrounding us, the first thing you offer in India is water to drink because the people who visit, the honored guests who visit, are thirsty. Then one offers water to wash the feet, which are dusty from the road. After this, in India traditionally one offers a garland of flowers. You may have seen this on pictures. Then one normally will light a couple sticks of incense to honor one's guests. Then one will offer some perfume or some perfumed ointment to put on the body of the guest. And after that, one spreads out a beautiful meal, and one has beautiful music and dancers perform during the meal. Now, in our visualization, we must bring as much of this into the visualization as possible and visualize, for instance, beautiful women, beautiful dancers, making these offerings and generating bliss within the mind of those to whom the offerings are made. So if possible, we should first arrange physically the offerings, as you seem to have done to Rinpoche's right. So we would put first two bowls of water, etc., in appropriate sequence. And then it is very important to make offerings with mudra. In other words, with one's two hands and the symbolic gestures for the offerings. The reason for this is that the mudra represents the manifestation of the five Dhyani Buddhas and their respective consorts, symbolized by the 10 fingers, which manifest as the various offerings. For instance, they manifest as Argam, as water, then as Padyam, you know? And all of these offerings are nothing else but a manifestation of the five Dhyani Buddhas and their consorts. Therefore, these offerings are of the nature of Buddhahood. So as to these offerings, we should think that every material offering, such as the apple Rinpoche shows, insofar as we can hold it within our two hands, becomes, if you want, an emanation of our two hands, with our two hands symbolizing respectively the five elements and the five wisdoms. In other words, the five elements are the five consorts, and the five wisdoms are the five Dhyani Buddhas, the five Buddhas, we say colloquially, of meditation. Now, every offering we make is actually of the nature of the union of the five elements and the five Dhyani Buddhas. This is also the case for our body. Our body is actually a manifestation of these various aspects. Then on page 8 of your Estonian text, you have the praise of Tara. With their very crowns, gods and demigods pay homage at your lotus feet, homage and praise to Mother Tara, Lady who liberates from every impoverishment. The first two verses, with their crowns, gods and demigods pay homage at your lotus feet, mean that the very crowns of beings, the very top of the head, touches the soil at the feet of the glorious Tara. Now, why should we pay homage, why should we pay respect to Tara in such an elaborate fashion? It is because Tara is like the mother of all sentient beings. She fulfills every one of their wishes, and specifically she grants them the two bodhicittas, conventional and ultimate bodhicitta, the wish for full enlightenment and wisdom. So she gives them what is most precious. Now, the next verse, where we say, Lady who liberates from every impoverishment. The term impoverishment here does not refer to material impoverishment. It refers to lack of faith. the lack of faith in the glorious Tara, which prevents us from establishing a connection with her. So we pray Tara to give us faith in her, and this obviously fulfills all of our other wishes. And the final verse in Tibetan, in English it's the first of the second line, homage and praise to Mother Tara, refers to Tara as our mother, precisely because she fulfills all of our desires as a mother fulfills all of our desires. So we now visualize ourselves as White Tara at this point of the sadhana. And this is a repeated process where again and again and again we visualize ourselves as White Tara, so that perhaps after a month or so we will have stability in the visualization. And at that point, then the memory, the awareness of being White Tara will be constantly with us in the same way as a mother is constantly aware of her child's whereabouts. You know, if her child is outside, she wants to know where he is. The awareness that she has a child never leaves her. In the same way, from our own side, that awareness of being one with White Tara never leaves us. At that point, the blessings of White Tara are able to penetrate us. And then we must become aware of the fact that from life to life, in all our future lives, we will be close friends, we will be on intimate terms with White Tara. However, the most important in this practice is not just the mere visualization of ourselves as White Tara, but also the acquisition of the mental capacities, the mental qualities of White Tara, and specifically the four immeasurables, without which such a visualization is just a mere appearance, and it will only produce a little bit of merit. It is only when we conjoin the visualization with the development of the mental qualities that we will gain great merit.
Okay.
So we have now a pause coming up, and during the pause, read carefully what we have studied so far, and if you have any questions, write them down, and you can ask them later.
Oh. Just say.